So Power Nickel came together really sort of around September 2020. Things started to turn. We saw, you know, we're called Chilean metals, and we felt Chile was getting a bit shaky geopolitically. So we started to look at other options as to, you know, where we could invest and just keep our Chile properties, but not put more capital at risk. So we acquired a project in BC, which we still have, which we like, called Golden Ivan. But then an opportunity came up to acquire NISK, and it came up because I had been working with Critical Elements, helping them, you know, with their refinancing, and I became aware of the project through another consultant that it was on their books, and I thought, wow, I've been working with these guys, and I didn't know it existed. So I said to John Sebastian Lavallee, who runs Critical, I'm saying, JS, look, you know, you got to spin this off. You can't be a lithium guy and a nickel guy. So you're not getting any value for it. Let me make a deal. And so we ended up making a fair deal for both sides, I think. And we acquired it from Critical Elements, where we fairly standard, you know, TSXV earn in. You know, we gave them, $500,000 cash. And at that time, it was 20% of our stock. It's now about, 10% or so. And we agreed to spend $5 million over a course of time to earn 80%, which we've now done. So now we basically, we're the operator of the project. We have 80% interest, and they have 20, and they still have the same position in our stock. They're 10%. They own the stock. So that's how we got the asset. And then it was a historic nickel asset. Had a historic resource of 3.1 million tons, I think, at the time. And then we basically expanded that to 7.2 million of a updated 43-101, about 1.13% overall, but growing, and it's getting better at depth. In looking to find more nickel sulfide, the host deposit is associated with ultramafic rock, and we are looking to expand on that. We had mapped the project when we acquired it. It was 46 square kilometers. And about 5.5 kilometers to the north and east, we had noted that an ultramafic expression at surface, an oleum anomaly, looked promising. We drilled it, and lo and behold, we found this great polymetallic discovery, and that sort of transformed the company. And that's the history of how we got here. You know, once we found that one hole, it was a bit of a winter target, so we hadn't anticipated it. So now we're drilling around the clock, around the calendar, because we're ready for it. But we had to wait until January. So we waited until January of this year, and then we started drilling, and that's when we had such crazy exploration success that truly transformed it into a polymetallic. And what do we mean by polymetallic? Bit of a big word. It basically means that your largest metal isn't necessarily your majority revenue stream. So in this case, nickel will be probably our largest metal, or it could be copper, but they will probably be 30-40%, copper probably 30-40%, and then other noble metals, which would be gold, silver, platinum, palladium, and even other palladium PGM elements in there. We expect we'll, at the end of the day, we could have as many as 11 paying minerals here. And that's really crazy. It was funny when we brought on Dr. Steve Beresford, who was his amazing pedigree. He's probably the top, if not the top, arguably amongst the top polymetallic geoscientists in the world. And so he came from First Quantum, where he was chief geo there, and then MMG, chief geo, and then chief scientific officer at IGO. So three big success stories. And I found him, actually, funny enough. My son is in the MinTwits on Twitter. You get there because you're a good analyst and you've made some forecasts and you get invited. It's not like you can just go there like Terry's not there, because that's not what Terry does. So, but my son he's a CFA. And so he had saw this interview that Steve Beresford had done on finding the next giant polymetallic deposit. And, for people that, just get a sense of the value of polymetallics, the world's most valuable mine is called Norilsk. And it's the only mine in the world that's ever produced or has like $1 trillion worth of metals. So that's how big it is. Like, another big one that people would know would be Platte Reef, which is Robert Friedland's a big polymetallic in Ivanhoe in South Africa. So these mines can be very, very large and be worth billions and billions of dollars. So they're rare as hell, but if you find them, they can be big. So, so you know, when we made this discovery, my son had watched this video and said, "Dad, look, I think this guy's talking about NISK, but of course he doesn't know we exist. You should reach out to him." So, you know, I often disparage LinkedIn because I've been paying my $70 or $80, whatever the hell they charge you a month, you know, to connect with people. And I'm thinking, I've never really gotten any value of the bloody thing. But you know, I reached out to Steve through LinkedIn and sent him some of our press releases. And I said, "Look, I think we got, you know, the next polymetallic that you're looking for. And I'd love to get your insight, you know." So he got back and he said, "Well, that's pretty cool." He said, "You know, what's your next plan?" I said, "Well, it's a winter target, so we probably can't get in until January." So we basically just started chatting, and he said, "Well, let me know how it goes." And of course, you know, it went phenomenal, as you know. We had that great discoveries, and then eventually we got Steve back on the line, went through a technical review with him, and he says, "Yep, okay, you've got one." So we hired him to come as our technical advisor, came over, spent a week on the site with our team, and, you know, it was fantastic. You know, he really, you know, he it was interesting. He had been trained in Western mining, which is like Australia's version of Inco, right? So a lot of great people came through Inco, a lot of great people came through Western mining. BHP eventually bought him, and then he went to First Quantum. But I didn't know that we use GeoVector to run our rigs, because a lot of times when you're a little guy, you have to use consultants to execute for you. That's the best way to leverage your dollars. So GeoVector is one of the top, you know, Joe Campbell's one of the top, you know, and his team are certainly one of the top geological consulting groups in the country. So they sit on the rig, they manage the core box, etc. So as it turns out, they're all Western mining guys. I didn't know this. So their data collections was exactly the same. So Steve was able to hit the ground running, and that was really important. And so we ended up, you know, just hitting it off, and he just loved the project. So he eventually has now come on as our board member and advisor. And it's like, wow, what a coup for us. I figured that's as important to me as the $20 million we raised from Friedland and McEwen and the mining funds. Because it's one thing to have money, but you got to have brains to execute with the money. You know, and it's like, you know, my job is to raise the money and do it at good levels for our shareholders, create shareholder value. But I'm not a scientist. I couldn't find, you know, gold if you spotted me several bars, you know. But these guys, they're amazing. You know, and like Steve said, look, there's a process here that we have to follow to really execute on this. And he says, it's not going to be cheap. It's going to be like 10 million. And this is what it's going to take. And I'm like, hey, I mean, that's why we hired you, right? No point in hiring world-class minds if you're not going to listen to them. So, you know, so that's what we're doing, and it's going great. So we're super psyched about what we're seeing right now at NISK. So obviously what drew them to the table was the, drilling assays, the results, and their understanding. When I was talking with Robert Friedland in New York, having a couple hour session with him, he said to me, he said he's never seen copper and PGMs like that in his life, no holes anywhere. And he said, look, one of two things have happened here. He said, either you salted the core, or it's a duck-billed platypus. And I started laughing, and he said, look, you wouldn't be here if I thought you salted the core. I know you don't even touch the core, so that's not possible. He says, you're here because this shouldn't have happened. Copper and PGM shouldn't be this high grade together, but it happened. So he says, in my life in mining, when something that shouldn't happen happens, then you're onto something exciting. He says, and that's why I'm at the table. So that obviously was, you know, the most compelling reason why he stepped up and became an investor. McEwen had come in earlier with a significant investment, and he obviously, you know, he's a sharp guy. He's often the earliest money in these, you know, really good seed deals like Great Bear, etc. And you know, he's a sharp guy, so he participated as well. And the mining funds, you know, they obviously wanted more, but we didn't want any more capital than that because we needed to execute because we, again, it's about creating value for our shareholders. We're not doing this because we want to waste money. We want to create value for investors, and you can do that by measured pieces. And of course, you hope to grow value, and then obviously raise money at a higher price down the road. But the polymetallics, when I was talking with Steve, he said, "Do you know how many ounces of gold Norilsk has produced?" I said, "I didn't even know they produced gold. I thought it was just nickel and palladium." He says, "No, 20 million ounces. That's crazy, man." But you know, I mean, I believe we'll have millions of ounces of gold in this project, and millions of ounces of PGMs. You know, and that gives you a lot of financing flexibility, right? Because now you've got streams, you've got different things you can do, and it's super. And it's like when we did the podcast last week where we did an exploration update with Steve Beresford and the team, and we were talking about North American nickel, and he was saying, look, he's not worried about Indonesian nickel. He says can't even compete with the polymetallic nickel that we'll be producing because our costs will be like $2, $3. So he said, you're going to make tons of money at whatever nickel is at. So, you know, so I think that's, you know, really powerful, you know, and so that's why investors have come to the story, and that's why more should come, you know, because, you know, obviously it's fallen back. And like I say to people today, you're buying, you know, at a better price now than the smart money bought, you know, a few months ago. And it's just been because, you know, summer doldrums and a bit of a quiet zone in the news cycle, I believe. And I think we're going to have a massive fall. You know, I really do. So as great as last year was, you know, or the first half, we think, you know, what we got going forward is going to be even better, you know, in a quantum way. And basically, we expect to make, obviously, more discoveries of the lion's own to advance that. We think that's going to grow to be a fairly sizable resource. We think that that's just going to be one of several. So we think we'll make several lion's own discoveries. The theory, you know, Dr. Steve Beresford, so there's really three theories about what's happening at NISK. The most likely theory, better than 50% chance, is that NISK Main, which is 5.5 kilometers to the southwest, is directly related subsurface to the lion's own 5.5 kilometers to the northeast. That creates a massive strike length. But he says in polymetallics, while they're super rare, they can have 8, 10, 20 kilometer strike length, so can be huge. The second most likely scenario would be that there's another nickel sulfide project we've yet to discover that's closer to Lion Zone, not connected to NISK, and that this is what's driving the Lion Zone. And he says that's quite common in polymetallic discoveries, that the nickel sulfide, and we already know, like we have high-grade nickel in the Lion Zone, like 2%, 1%, 3% nickel, so it's there in the PGMs. So typically what happens is some sort of hydrothermal action came down in the oven of the nickel sulfide, which is probably deeper at 750, 1,000 meters, 1,250 meters. Nickel is heavy with iron, sinks, so it's deeper in the system. So this hydrothermal action came up, swept up the copper sulfide, and this is what we were seeing in the copper, you know, with the, you know, in the Lion Zone, we a very copper-dominated system. But they predict we'll have shoots that'll be gold-centric, silver-centric, platinum, palladium-centric, etc., and even zinc-centric. And so we're expecting, you know, through the process that we're going through right now to identify first those other zones and the extensions of the Lion Zone, all at the same time as we're trying to vector in to what we think is the big prize that's yet either we're on the fringe of the system with NISK Main, or there's a big prize underneath there that we haven't found yet. And that could turn us into the next Sakati or hopefully the next Norilsk. We don't know, but it could be big. I mean, we don't mind taking risk. We want to take a little bit of risk, but we need a lot of upside. So, I mean, honestly, I think we're trading at a fraction of what other comparable polymetallics are trading at right now. And we have as much upside or more than any of them. And it's like, you're not paying for it. So, wow, that's fantastic. And that's what should get you doing your due diligence on Power Nickel, I think.